Hey sports fans, today on Philstar Home Base, we've got top 200 WTA player Lizette Cabrera. Born to Filipino parents in Townsville, Australia, she currently represents Down Under in the WTA Tour, but always makes sure to wear her Filipino heritage with pride. Join us as we talk to her about her tennis journey and the importance of having a life outside of her sport. The 23-year-old also shares about her dreams and what she can do to grow the sport in the Philippines. Join us only here on Philstar Home Base. Okay, so hi everyone. Welcome to Home Base. Thank you for Lizette for coming here. We welcome her. It's awesome to see you.
Yeah, thank you for having me. I'm really excited to be on the show.
Yeah, so Lizette, I think we have a little bit of, you know, catching up to do because last we've heard, you know, you were injured, you posted on your social media, and, you know, how have you been holding up until right now?
Yeah, I've been good. It has been a few tough weeks with being injured, but I've still been able to do lots of fitness and kind of keep on track. So that's been really nice. But I just started hitting again last week, and I'm super excited because I'm planning to go play French Open, and I'll be leaving for that in like 2 weeks. So yeah, it's really exciting to be back on court and not be injured and just having to do rehab in the gym.
Yeah. Can you give us a little more details on what happened to you and, you know, what's your timetable?
Yeah. So I've always had a little bit with my sort of elbow, and I've had a few niggles with it. And yeah, just over the summer, it kind of got progressively worse. And then we had a scan and there was a little bit of a tear in it, so I needed to rest and do some rehab, wait for it to heal, and now that it has, I can kind of plan and go overseas, which is so exciting because I've been really looking forward to competing again. So yeah, I'll head for French Open, and then I'll look to head to the UK for the grass season.
Yeah, that's great to hear that, you know, it's all good right now and you're ready to go back. But speaking of going overseas, you know, how's the COVID situation there in Australia right now? And, you know, as an athlete who often travels, are you planning or have you gotten vaccinated for COVID already?
Yeah, so we've been pretty lucky in Australia that we haven't had many cases. It's been very normal where I live in Queensland. You know, I think Australia's done a really good job of abiding with the rules, you know, whenever there is a lockdown, which has made it better for us now. I have gotten my first vaccine, and I think I'll get the second dose when I'm in the UK, hopefully.
Yeah, that's great to hear. So, you know, it's better to be safe for everyone.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah.
Yeah. So you recently had, you know, a stint in the Australian Open. That was your last major tournament before, you know, the injury. What was your main takeaway from that?
My main takeaway was I got to play on Rod Laver Arena against the number 2 in the world, which was an amazing experience, but it was also kind of a wake-up call. I think I didn't play the way I wanted to, even though I did have a very good preseason leading in. I was really thinking I was going to do well, so it's kind of made me even more motivated to get back out there and just really kind of play my level and hopefully win some more matches and improve my ranking.
Yeah, you mentioned playing against Simona in the Australian Open, right? But do you think when you had that match, how do you think you kind of like compare to them in terms of, you know, competitiveness, because you also train with, you know, the likes of Ash Barty. Do you think you're already heading to where you want to go right now in terms of, you know, what you want to achieve with, you know, what you're doing or what you can do with your tennis?
Yeah, I think a lot of the top players have that really good emotional control, especially under pressure in those big moments. They always win and they're always kind of level-headed. And I think that's usually one of my main strengths is my mentality. So that's something I'm really working towards because that's one thing I can control at all times. And yeah, I think I am heading in the right direction. I think I just got to keep doing the little things right and hopefully it will pay off. And yeah, hopefully I'm in top 100 this year. That's the goal.
Yeah, in your rankings, you've been in the top 200, you know, your career high, I think, is 115. Can you tell us about the journey, you know, to get where to where you are now. You know, you're still 23. You're obviously, you know, younger. You know, how did you get to where you are, and what were the challenges along the way?
Yeah, I had a lot of challenges. At one point, I was going to go to college in America, and I was there, but then something didn't add up with a certificate from high school. So I had to come back to Australia. And so I just decided I'm going to, you know, try go professional here instead of when I was in the States. And even that was a massive challenge for me because, you know, I was still studying to try to get back overseas. And once I kind of made that decision to stay, it was like there was this weight lifted off my shoulders and I could kind of focus just on tennis now. And yeah, and just get through that. And I think a lot of the challenges I've faced have made me mentally tougher and just like better after all that. I know I just from growing up, it's something that I've always wanted to do is become a professional tennis player, and I'm willing to sacrifice and work really hard for it. And yeah, I'm just hoping that I can continue to improve and build and yeah, just keep working towards that top 100 goal.
Yeah. Do you think there's a lot of pressure on you, like when you first started out or even now, you know, like, and how do you kind of like handle that? You say that, you know, like for you, you feel like your emotions are, you know, always in check and you have that mental toughness. How do you handle that?
Yeah, I think you always feel a little bit of pressure. You know, now that I'm a bit older and I kind of, you know, everything's on me with my income and I have to pay for a lot of things, you know, week to week, it's easy to focus on, you know, when your results, when you're not doing well. And, you know, that is your main source of income. So there is that sort of pressure. And then also the pressure of doing well and, you know, because you work so hard and you want to make your team proud and yourself and your family. But I just try and like journal a lot. I speak to a psychologist and just try and make sure I'm doing the right things to control my emotions, because especially when you're having a tough stint and say you're not winning many matches, it's easy to get really down and kind of go off track a little bit. So that's something that I've really been focusing on since I've been injured, is just making sure I'm keeping my mind healthy and happy and yeah, just making sure that I'm ready when I go back on tour.
Yeah, you mentioned, you know, talking to a psychologist. So like sports psychology, is it, I feel like it's a field that, you know, that's been growing traction for a lot of athletes. Personally for you, you know, what do you think does it do to help you, especially on the court? Like how does it translate to, you know, real life results in, you know, what you're doing?
Yeah, I think a sports psychologist is a really good avenue for any athlete. I think it's a good way to really dig deep and kind of go through things that you might not speak about with other people, and also find out what works for you. You know, it works for me and it might not work for everyone. But I know that when I have something that I'm worried about or under stress, it's good to talk about it with a professional. And we kind of go through routines that will help me get through it. And it's also a way of just, you know, not focusing too much on like tennis as well, like kind of in a way that like you're focusing on your mind as well as the tennis, because if you don't train your mind, you can't perform kind of under the pressure and in those big moments. So that's one thing I really want to do better during Oz Open. And yeah, I'm hoping when those bigger moments come this year that I feel more ready. And yeah.
All right. So, you know, before we move on to the next few questions, I have, you know, a short segment for you. So it's called Fastball. I'll be asking you, you know, a few short questions. No pressure. You know, just it's just like simple questions, like maybe one or two words or one or two sentences. Are you ready?
Yeah, I'm ready.
All right. So what's your favorite pregame meal?
Love pasta or rice.
Nice. What's your hype song for training or when you go to a match?
I love Drake. Anything, he'll get me hyped up.
Yeah. What's your favorite surface to play on?
Grass.
Mm-hmm. What's your go-to shot on the court?
Love my backhand line.
Yeah. What's your favorite pastime, you know, outside of tennis?
Favorite pastime? I don't know, just all moments I get to spend with my family and friends. Yeah, I'd say that.
What's your favorite Filipino food?
Oh, that's a hard one. Either pancit or sinigang.
Yeah, and finally, who's your tennis goat?
Serena Williams.
Yeah, that's great. So, you know, that's easy, you know. you did great.
Thank you.
Yeah, so the next few questions, you know, we're going to go about your Filipino heritage because, you know, obviously a lot of Filipino fans want to know more about you and, you know, how you're integrated into the culture. So, yeah, speaking of the culture, you were born in Australia, but, you know, how does your family, you know, kind of keep that Filipino culture, you know, going on in your everyday life?
Yeah, well, my mom is an amazing cook, and also my grandparents are too. And I've learned lots of recipes also from my dad. And we always eat Filipino food at home. And I think that's a way of kind of keeping that Filipino heritage there, even when I am in Australia. And also, like, mom has a lot of Filipino friends in Australia. So I am around a lot of Filipinos. So I am kind of engaging and hearing Tagalog a lot, and yeah, I still feel like very connected, and I definitely love learning about the Philippines, and I always ask mom lots of questions on how she grew up and kind of like schooling and university over in the Philippines and how it's different in Australia. And yeah, so that's how I kind of keep it in my day-to-day life.
Yeah, speaking of that Filipino community, do you kind of feel that support, you know, from the Filipino, your fellow Filipinos there in Australia? Because, you know, like, it's kind of harder for us from here, the other side of the world, you know, to express that support to you. But, you know, when you're around Filipinos, do you sort of feel that, you know, love that you kind of like, you know, even if you do have an Australian flag beside your name on the tennis court, do you still feel, you know, you're a Filipino whenever you step on that court?
Yeah, definitely. I feel like I represent both the Philippines and Australia, and I feel very lucky to have a lot of Filipino fans as well. And mm-hmm. It's taken me a few years to actually kind of connect with the Philippines and kind of get my name out there. And, you know, I think it's really important, especially for young boys and girls, to see a lot of athletes coming up. And yeah, I'd love to be a role model for the younger ones.
Yeah. About the younger ones, you know, like, what's your advice to, you know, Filipinos who really want to get into tennis? Because I'm not sure if you know, but, you know, the craze here in the Philippines is all about basketball, you know, but obviously there are also kids, you know, who want to be where you are right now in the future, right?
Yeah, for sure. I think if you love it and you enjoy it, I think it's so easy. You can just, you know, pick up a racket and a ball and hit against the wall if you don't have anyone to hit with. You know, that's how a lot of us started. I started by hitting against the wall, and it's just good fun. And I think it also builds community. You know, if you go to your local tennis club, you'll meet a lot of good people and you'll make friendships out of it. And, you know, if you really enjoy it and you're passionate about it, you could, you know, make a career out of it like me. And you never know. I think tennis brings a lot of opportunities, and I'm so grateful that it's my job, because it doesn't feel like a job. It's my passion. And yeah, I think it's so easy to start. And even if you're just doing it socially, yeah, it's so much fun, and it's a good way to keep fit as well.
Yeah, I think we've heard from you from the last time, you know, we interviewed you with Philippine media, that you were in the Philippines before, you know, once. Do you plan on visiting real soon? And, you know, what do you want to do here in terms of tennis? Do you plan on doing anything to, you know, to kind of like promote the sport here?
Yeah, I'm hoping once COVID dies down, and if my schedule is okay, that I can make a stop in the Philippines and visit some of my other family there, and also, you know, help promote tennis over there. I also work with this Australian foundation called the Project Six Foundation, and mm-hmm. they help kind of underprivileged communities with like providing equipment and trying to help out in any way. And we were speaking about possibly doing an exhibition match in the Philippines at some point, so I'd love to do that. And even if it was just an event, maybe we could raise some money to help some communities or people that young players or clubs that, you know, want to get into tennis but maybe don't have the equipment. I'd love to like help there as well. But yeah, I think there's lots of opportunities if I did come over. So yeah, exciting.
That's exciting. Yeah, we look forward to it when you know everything is back to normal. You know, speaking of your fellow Filipino tennis players, you know, Alex Ayala and her brother Miko, you know, they're making waves of their own. I guess as an older tennis player, you know, what could you advise to, you know, Alex in particular? She's also part of the WTA tour, like being, you know, being there, I guess, a little bit longer than she has been. You know, what do you want to say to her that, you know, that she might not hear from other people?
I think she's doing amazing already. I think she's done a good job of setting herself up with a good team at the Rafa Nadal Academy. And it looks like, you know, her career is starting to really take off. And I would just say to keep working hard and keep enjoying it. And yeah, just to make sure you surround yourself with the right people, because at the end of the day, you can't do it alone. Sometimes you need help. And yeah, it's really important that you have the right people there that care for you as a tennis player, but as well as a human being as well. So, yeah.
Yeah, we recently interviewed her in the other episode for this show, and we asked her about you, you know, like, because I remember you mentioned that you wanted, you know, maybe to play doubles with her. And I told her, hey, you know, Lizette wants to play doubles with you. And she was, you know, she was very excited about it. And she just said, you know, she just needed to go bump up her rankings a little bit before. But yeah, that's so exciting to you know, see you guys compete at, you know, the top level. Yeah, but you know, let's go back to you. You said that you wanted to get into the top 100. Do you see that as, you know, a feasible goal for you in this tennis season?
Yeah, definitely. I think if I can continue to build every week and just kind of go deep in tournaments and keep healthy, I definitely think it's an achievable goal. I don't like to put too much pressure on myself. I just kind of like to stay in the present and focus on kind of one match at a time. I think in the past I have been so close that I have been like, I need to make it, or if I don't make it, you know, this is going to happen or whatever. And yeah, I just don't want to put that pressure on myself. But yeah, I honestly think that if I stay healthy and keep working really hard, it's definitely very achievable.
Yeah, I know you're young and you're, you know, you may be at the peak of your career right now, but you know, let's go into some maybe your future plans. Like maybe after tennis, do you see yourself maybe going into a coaching job, or what do you see yourself, you know, out when you finish that career as a player?
Yeah, that's a question I've kind of struggled with the last couple of years. You know, I want to make sure that I do have an identity outside of tennis. You know, when people introduce me to their friends, it's always like, oh, Lizette, the tennis girl. It's never just Lizette, you know? And I want to make sure that I, you know, set myself up for after my career. And, you know, I have thought about coaching. I love tennis and I love helping people. And I think my experience could help some younger players. I've also thought about psychology and that avenue, maybe studying that. And just, I love like the marketing side of business. So that's something I'm really interested in as well. So there's a few things that I am thinking about, but obviously I'm still kind of focused on my tennis now. But yeah, those are the few things that I think I might do after tennis.
Yeah. What you mentioned earlier, it's kind of an interesting take, you know, like you want one thing to have an identity out of the sport. You know, because a lot of like fans or maybe journalists like me, you know, when we see you guys, we kind of like, hey, think, you know, like tennis, it's tennis, it's who you are, you know. How important is it, you know, for an athlete to, you know, build other things outside of their sports, at least for you personally? Like, how do you value that, you know, building that your kind of like, you know, identity and your world outside of the tennis? Because obviously it's not, you know, it's not going to be forever for you.
Yeah, of course. I think a lot of athletes are just so focused on, you know, their sport now, which is totally fine. But for me, like, you know, your career is actually really short. It's only a third of your life. And you have so much more of your life after tennis or after your sport. And yeah, for me, it's like making sure that I don't kind of see tennis as just who I am. It's what I do, but it's not who I am. And just creating that kind of difference and separating that, because I think it's really easy to be really upset if I'm losing, because mm-hmm. I think, you know, tennis is who I am and blah, blah, blah. But if I go, you know what, tennis is what I do, and like results don't affect the person that I am, how I treat people and everything, I think that's really important. But yeah, and I just want to make sure that I have options after tennis and I don't just kind of put all my eggs in one basket and just focus on tennis, because I do have a lot of downtime. I, with now like COVID and the bubble, so I can do like lots of reading, lots of research, and kind of figuring out what I enjoy besides tennis.
Yeah, that's great. So yeah, I guess just the last question for me, you know, some parting shots for your supporters here in the Philippines and also the Filipino community there in Australia.
Thank you for following me and supporting me. And if you love tennis, I hope I've inspired you to pick up a racket and just go play and have fun. And yeah, that's all I have.
All right. Thank you so much, Lizette, for your time today. And thank you for tuning in to Home Base, guys. Thank you.
Thank you. Bye.